Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It is the second half of our first day of the Rainbow Six Siege Pro League, coming to you live from Katowice, Poland, where we are at the Intel Extreme Masters Expo. And so far, we've seen all of our eight teams duke it out. They've played. The table is now set. We've got a team on the top with 2 points, a whole bunch of teams with 1 point, and then one picking up the rear with zero. But that can all change, because we're going through, we're letting them all play again. Basically, 2 days for the price of one. What does that mean for you? You're about to see more action. We've seen some really good games so far. I'm gonna tell you, I've been enjoying this stuff, and I hope you have been too, because that's exactly why these teams have come here from all across Europe, battling it out to be able to play in this Pro League. They had to qualify to get here. This is the Pro League for the PC for EU. There is, of course, the PC for North America, and then there's the same two regions on the Xbox One. Loads of awesome Rainbow Six Siege action. Coming up now, we've got our friends from Italy who just did the first 5-0 of the Pro League, so they've got that under their belt already. We had a nice chat with Torek, and he was very open with saying he's excited to be here, and also a little bit flabbergasted of what's going on. And standing in their way are Area, who of course earlier on today took it up against, let me check here, team of, I can't even see them, I think. They were first up against TCM. So I'm sure that they're ready to get their fingers back on the keyboard and prove exactly why they're here. But enough of me talking. This crowd is beginning to fill up again because they know what time it is. It's Pro League time, and none other than Rainbow Six Siege. So without further ado, from the stage, while the guys get warmed up, let's head over to the man who always can, and that's Panky.
Thank you very much, Sean, and welcome back to a nice, small, compact analyst desk. Now, goes back to the cast desk, and I'm here with the one and only True Talent on our own. You still enjoying Poland? You still happy now that we finished game one of play day? I know it's hot.
Yeah, I'm loving it. I'm really looking forward to this next match.
Really?
Really.
All right, fine. We'll go straight into the next match. Our esports versus that Flamers. I mean, personally, Chaman Tunji and I talked about it. So Flamers 5-0 sweeping in that first map, Chalet last game. Incredibly impressive. Why are you so excited for this match?
I thought it was going to be the opposite. I thought it was literally going to be 5-0 with Epsilon. Mm-hmm. Them taking 5 out of Epsilon, I really want to see what they do versus Area.
After seeing that play, why do you think they managed to take that 5 from Epsilon? What do you think they did so well?
Just everything right. Pretty much,
that's
yeah.
True, exactly. Like every time and they cleared every floor, got every kill, won every firefight, and were attacking every objective.
Came out of nowhere.
Yeah, huge number advantage. So yeah, very well executed on Chalet. They didn't have quite as strong of a showing on Bank. Do you think that's what it was? Do you think is they've got that one map down and nailed, or do you think they can still do it on some other?
They were saying that they were a bit weaker. They felt a bit weaker on Bank, but maybe Epsilon were like, come on, we need to do better than this. So maybe they pushed themselves further. It could have been a lot of different things.
Yeah, we also had obviously Epsilon on there earlier saying how they focused on 5 match specifically. Maybe Chalet was one of the ones they focused on a little
Yes, possibly.
Because it is a very popular one in the matchmaking world.
Apparently, yeah.
That somehow, even though it's randomized, happens a lot. So maybe they felt they were okay on that without too much practice. Flamers went, no, this is what happens when you practice this map.
Yeah, exactly. 5-0.
Era obviously played TCM earlier on. Was there anything that stood out in that game that you feel Era need to improve on?
I don't know, really. I think every team I've seen so far has been playing pretty much, you know, top level. I can't see many gaps.
Game day, we had so many draws. Is brilliant. It's exactly what we expect from the Pro League, or what we hoped for from the Pro League. We didn't want everything to be complete one-sided sweeps, and we got exactly that. And even as we're punching an image before, even the one that did go 2-0 was very, very close to being a draw as well.
Yeah.
So everyone is very evenly matched, and we've got so many more weeks now.
We've got a kind of underdog who potentially can, you know, maybe take it all, Flamers. Yeah.
And we've got so many more weeks where everyone can just completely learn and change and adapt.
Yep.
Let's look at the rest of our Play Day 2 games. Penta Esports versus GBots. Gifu versus Warrior Team France, and Epsilon versus TCM. Out of those three, what's your next most anticipated matchup?
Penta, GBots. It'll have to be that one. I think so. Both teams really strong. Both teams have got a lot of hype behind them. They, you know, people are saying that they're doing well. They're all doing well, basically. So it'll be interesting seeing that kind of clash of the titans, so to speak.
Oh, cool. So we'll look for that in the future. But now we've got Era Flamers on Consulate and Cafe. Two completely new maps of the Pro League. Day two, as it is, and everyone's changing it again. Mm. Which of those two is your favorite?
Consulate. Mm-hmm. Yeah, really do like that one. It's quite a big map. I feel it's quite well designed. There's loads of different places you can go. Quite a balanced map, I'd say. It was in the beta as well.
It was. It's one of these few maps we mentioned before, how everyone puts such a strong force on the basement. Mm. It's got a couple of different options to be down in that base level.
You can go different places, yeah. So we'll attack it from all different places. A lot of maps are kind of like that, though, really.
That's true. Lots of them have different spawns. It's quite a unique factor. But let's have a quick look at these teams again, in case you've forgotten who's on Arrow. They were obviously early on in the date, so we'll get that. We'll show them in a moment. We'll run down them, give them their moment of fame again, and then we'll go to Flamers. Flamers are, of course, very comfy in the seats, still on the same side of the stage.
Yeah.
Didn't have to move much at all. But Era, back in their seats, back in settled, comfy, and definitely refreshed off their first game. Just in case you forgot them, LMG Panix, who had that phenomenal 4v1 round in their Oregon map phase at one point. Enemy, Revan, and Undead, who, again, I've got to say thank you for him to come up here on the stage. I like their... their way of breaking down their team. They have three turret players, as they call them, and two roamers. Those three turrets that just sit on the objectives and are more or less immovable objects that just sit there and shoot it
when
it comes close, and then have those two roamers. Yes, obviously it's still a new game, everyone's figuring out the different things, but I'd be interested to see how many other teams either split their roles up further and have, like, everyone has a very specific different role.
Be interesting if
three turrets, two roamers, or
it'd be interesting if you had a team who just did all roamers, like just all roaming around the map.
I mean, I think it would be awful, not gonna lie. But they went, let's take Rook and four roamers.
Just one round, just wing it. Try it.
They'd be completely surprised if there's no one at the
It would. It would surprise.
Exactly. But all that flamers. Is Era Black on your screen, and now we're back over to Flamers. This team creating such a splash in that last game. A team that, again, everyone had written off, but really came through and said, no, we're here to fight, we're here to win this as well. And as I mentioned, they are our Italian team, which is a new one. There's not so many Italian teams in the global esports infrastructure. QB, Epic, Alation, Boros, and Torak. Again, thank you to him for a great interview earlier on. So everyone's settled and ready. I want to talk a bit more about, you've talked about Consulate, how you like Consulate, how they play from Raceman. Cafe Dostoevsky, most recently, has just had an entire attacker spawn removed.
Because they could shoot through the windows, I'm guessing.
In amongst the whole spawn. Spawn reshuffle.
Which one was it?
It was the East Park Main Street.
I can see that.
Killed on. They've taken it off anyway. So I don't think it's going to affect the competitive spawns too much. People are River Dock, Park Alley, and Christmas Market anyway.
I think it'll be okay.
Yeah, I think it'll be fine. But we are ready to see exactly how that game unfolds. We have another dynamic duo down in the cast. So any final thoughts?
I am really excited about this game. I hope you guys are.
Perfect thought. So we're going to go back down to our caster desk. Joe Fenny and Derek Mallon, please take it away.
Thank you very much, guys. And we are here back on the caster desk. I'm going to be here for the rest of the day. And, of course, I am joined by Bungie for the first time, actually. First time we're casting together.
Mixing it up a little, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And we're going to be seeing what looks to be on paper a phenomenal game. If the Flamers can live up to that first game of the last match.
If they bring that back, this is going to be a good one.
It's going to be absolutely
be real
insane.
Good.
I don't feel like Good is like giving them enough credit right there, because the Flamers just...
I'm getting hype!
I mean, not to pun too hard, but the Flamers were on fire in that first map. And they're going to be going up against Era. I know, I'm sorry. they're going up against Era. And Era, I mean, we saw Panix. Panix just went insane. Like, the 4v1 with Smoke, got the 4 headshots
that
with his...
That was definitely the clutch of the day. Haven't seen anything better yet.
Well, fingers crossed, we're going to see some crazy stuff coming out here. But we are already onto the map. We're already underway. And it looks like the Flamers are going to be kicking off the defenses. So, talk me through here, Derek. Talk me through the compositions that we're seeing coming out. Pretty similar stuff to what we've seen so far, really.
Yeah, it's, I'm a little surprised that they... Well, I guess I'm not actually for that site, but you know, it's always good, I think, to open up something in between A and B. Don't leave it so that if you lose one site, you're stuck trying to just push through the one door left open. You know, open up a wall or two, but...
It's almost like you don't want to be caught suddenly being the attackers when you're defending.
Right, exactly. And the more holes you have open, the more you can kind of clean up the point you're not on.
Yeah, it's kind of... one of the good strategies that you kind of see is when you can defend a site without actually being on the site.
Right.
You blow that wall wide open, then you can just use that as almost like a shooting range.
You can shoot from behind B through into the garage and cover A as well.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, we'll see whether any of that kind of stuff comes out. We are going to see from the eyes of Panix,
our MVP the last time he was up, right?
Absolutely, and he's going to be going for the Twitch. So different, well, I say different strategy. Obviously, he's on attack, so he can't really play smoke right now. We'll see how he's going to do. I mean,
Like, as far as weapons go, the FAMAS is pretty, the F2 is pretty much the big smoke. Yeah, it's the big SMG-11, you know?
It's pretty terrifying. I mean, I've seen different opinions on the weaponry from Twitch. I'm a huge fan of the F2, but I've seen a couple of people prefer his or her other primary. I mean, what's your personal opinion on the Twitch weaponry?
That kind of rate of fire and one-shot headshots. I mean, as long as you're spraying upper chest area, it's going to evaporate.
You're going to hit the face eventually. It's like my mom always
got
said.
The garage open like nothing, which is pretty impressive.
Yeah, that was. I mean, the EMP didn't even go through the letterbox at the bottom. Yeah. It was kind of just like, oh well, I guess it worked anyway. So.
But I mean, Thatcher's EMP takes everything out in like a 200-mile radius anyway.
Yeah, it's pretty much like. It's like the old killstreak EMP on Modern Warfare 2.
Oh, yeah.
It's like just destroyed the whole map. But here we go. First kill already coming across. Revan going to pick that one up with a nice little headshot there. So that's going to be that Flamers on the defensive side with just four defenders remaining. So good start here for Era. And we'll see if they can be more successful on this first map than we saw Epsilon being.
Right. He saw that drone and deuced out fast.
Yeah, that bear trap as well. He's just like,
all three frost traps down.
Ain't getting caught by this. Actually, almost caught Frost there as well. But going to be able to dodge on down. Here we go. I'm interested to see kind of how they spread out for this one, whether they kind of all go in together or whether we see kind of one by one. Ooh, oh, we are going to see, actually, he gets dropped down on the stairs. And it's going to be Frost, who we were talking about, does take the kill in the end.
Him while he was changing positions. You see that? He was, like, prone backwards and switched around, and while his leg flung out, he hit him with a pre-fire and killed him.
Beautiful shot coming out, and that's going to be another couple of kills. And actually, Flame is turning this one around. That's an SMG kill coming out there, I believe, from QB as well. But now, it's 2v3, so really could go either way. And as I say that, that's going to be Torek getting a headshot down. We're going to see enemy pushing on in, finds one for himself, and he's going to be looking for more as he starts to get this diffuser down. He's all on his own, but we are going to see Jaeger is down but not out. So basically, him versus Bandit.
Who is right there?
There you have it. The second you say it's a 1v1, he's like, oh, 1v1, I'll pop this guy's head then.
Well, excuse me.
There it is.
His fingers are still typing as he got up.
Excuse me, do you have a moment to talk about headshots? There we go. So, I mean, technically a triple kill at the end there. I don't know if it quite counts because one of them was down but not out. But I mean, four kills in the first round.
With a plant and almost an ace, I'd say count it. Yeah.
I mean, he got the same amount of kills and points as the entire enemy team. So he's feeling pretty confident. He's feeling pretty comfortable. And that is going to be the first round going over to Era. So Dat Flame is now work cut out here. And I mean, this is a team that in that last match just straight up 5-0'd the first map. So
right.
I'm interested.
And they held their own in the second one too. It wasn't a total. They didn't win, but they weren't a shutout either.
No, I think it was like 5-2 on bank, I believe.
Yeah.
So I mean, they got a couple of rounds for themselves, and it was kind of a. You could tell that it was very much, and we heard in the interview with Sean as well. It was very much a matter of we have practiced Chalet a lot, and that is a map that we are good at, and obviously we clearly saw that. So, I mean, that's how much do you think that's kind of a theme throughout our day so far is kind of these teams being specifically good on certain maps? Do you think that's been...
I think in a game like this with so many angles and so many ways that you can just get shot in the face from, map knowledge is more important than anything. Whether you're good at 1v1ing people, winning gunfights, whether you're good at communication, all of it's pretty irrelevant if you don't know the maps. That is by far the most important thing.
Yeah, I mean... It's great if you can aim, but if you don't know where you need to be aiming, then, I mean, what's the point, you know? So
it's all secondary to map knowledge in this game, I think.
And I think
more
as well,
so than any other game.
It's kind of like almost a second nature. When you see these players going through these rooms like systematically, you see them check each and every single corner that they know is a common spot. And that's kind of... When you're at this stage, when you're in the Pro League, you've got to be able to do that. You've got to know each and every corner. You've got to be able to check that each and every time perfectly.
Exactly.
Here we go then. So 2 minutes on the clock for this second round. This time it's going to be Era on defense. They're feeling pretty comfortable so far. No kills on the board just yet for either team. And we're seeing Flamers very, very spread out attack here.
Yeah, they're definitely not playing together. I mean, not to say that they aren't using teamwork, but they're very one you know, one in each corner of the map, kind of.
Yeah, it's almost like they're looking for, like, tiny skirmishes rather than the kind of
right.
big...
It is risky, though. It leaves them open to just kind of get picked one by one.
Yeah.
If they're not moving in perfectly in sync, then they're essentially just attacking one-on-one.
Yeah.
Or one at a time.
This is one of the things as well, is it's like, if you can get it so that you all come from different directions at the same time, then fantastic. You got a pincer going, they don't know where to look. Like, that's always going to be a great situation. But
that's very tough.
Exactly.
It is tough to get everybody moving the same amount towards the point. We actually saw it in an earlier match where they had a perfect pinch. I forget which team it was, but they had a you know, Twitch on one side, two on the other,
yeah.
and the Twitch was just too slow catching up, and it ended up just kind of being one at a time instead of a perfect pinch.
Yeah, they kind of trickle in and slowly but surely fall apart. I mean, that's one of the things as well later on in the Pro League that we're more likely to see more often. That is going to be the first kill of the round, though. LM's does manage to find
getting picked one at a
second
time
for himself. That MP5, man, is terrifying. Oh, there's another
down.
Another one coming through as well. In fact, that one's going to be from Boros. He didn't actually finish the kill off. Down but not out. Can't quite end that guy. But Thatcher going to be going down as well. There's another one for Evan.
Case in point. It can work, but it's, I mean, you got to be, a team that knows each other very well and really has that synergy and that connection going.
Yeah, and as well, like, if you are in a situation where one person can get two kills, why is neither of you looking in that direction?
Right.
That's the question you've got to pull up. It's like, if there's two of you, you've got to be covering different spots, and you've got to communicate that with your team as well, because otherwise, as we saw there, it can kind of slowly but surely fall apart, but ERA definitely not falling apart here. You can see solid teamwork coming through, two rounds on the trot now, and they're going back onto that attacking side. So, I mean, right now, DaFlamers, they can go to the same spots as they did before because they lost the first round. So,
right.
Interesting that they go for this kind of basement, because the B site is very, very close to an external wall. Do you think that that makes it kind of very vulnerable?
I think it's a make or break type deal. If Bandit can win the little battery trick and win his Bandit plants, then B becomes a very great site, because now, like, the second those thermites are gone, you can start opening up everything to A, and now you have a fully fortified area where you just have to watch the stairs and in front of you.
Yeah.
And it's extremely hard to push once that happens, if you can pull off the Bandit plants.
Yeah,
if you lose it, the second there's a hole there, it becomes a much more difficult game, and I honestly think defending B mostly through A becomes the better push there.
Yeah, kind of just taking out that middle wall that's on your screen right now, and then, as you said before, kind of turning that into a shooting range almost, so you
exactly.
can just sit back and watch them come in. But
it's just it's kind of a high-risk, high-reward bomb site, you know?
And I think that's kind of... it's interesting to see which... nearly butterfingers that one and
grenades
takes off his own
definitely
legs.
Tricky to get them to do what you want in this game.
Yeah, it's kind of, if you don't get that bounce to go through the letterbox, it won't just roll through, because there's a little bit of a lip at the bottom. But he gets away with it.
Yep, there it is. It's open, so...
Oh, did that get... No, that got denied.
It's...
Oh, no, yeah.
It's a glitch I believe they have getting fixed in a near pad. I think that it was in the last patch notes, but occasionally that can happen, apparently, where it only thermites like part of the wall.
Okay, so tell me what I'm looking at right there. What's is that something that we can see differently to him, or?
No, it's just a bug where for some reason sometimes thermite doesn't quite open the wall the way it's supposed to. It's not intended, and it is something they've addressed and something they're obviously aiming to fix, but yeah, it worked in the other one.
Yeah, they managed to get the hole in the wall regardless, so to some extent, I would argue maybe a better side of the wall anyway, because you've got the cover from the van as well.
I definitely like the right side of the middle. I prefer to open over the left, so.
Yeah,
because it works out in the long run.
Yeah, so I guess they got away with it in the end. That is going to mean, though, thermite charges down, so. I mean, we do have one kill on the board already for ERA, so two rounds up, they're a kill up as well. They're feeling pretty darn confident.
A kill up with the garage open is a pretty good deal.
And as well,
two kills.
Yeah, so there we go. And LM's always seems to be the player getting that first frag. He always seems to be the entry fragger. And I mean, you've played a lot of this game yourself.
Right.
Are we going to see like a pause for this one? Okay, we are actually going to see a restart. I would assume that's to do with
that bug.
The bug, yeah. I mean, like, that's pretty huge. If you lose one of those thermite charges, it's kind of, you know.
Yeah, but they were winning.
Yeah, I mean,
I'd have just taken it if it was up to me.
Yeah, I don't know. It's I don't really know the specifics of the rulings when it comes to that kind of thing. Right. Obviously, that's all written in the rule book. But
and I mean, it's still a new game. This is the first pro tournament with it. And it is a bug they've acknowledged. They know it exists.
Yeah.
Just something that didn't quite make it to the...
I'm sure there is something in the rule book specific to this. But
that,
I mean, the rule book's for our referees to deal with.
Yeah.
I am but a mere commentator. I don't know all the ins and outs of like super specific
stuff.
We
have better
like
things to do, like mindlessly ramble about whatever.
I really love the little Scottish dinosaur he's got going on his monitor there as well. My little brother used to have one that looked exactly like that. I want to know if it's like the same one or not, but
yeah,
he used to like squeeze the belly and it'd sing some bizarre little jingle or whatever. But yeah, it looks like just trying to work out what's going on. I think in this scenario, I believe we'll be just kind of restarting the round but continuing
with
previous score. So it'll be still 2-0 to Era.
So just like a disconnect or anything else, you count where the rounds were at previously, but you start a new one.
Yeah, so it's going to be... we'll just be getting this underway again for you guys. But Era with a very, very strong start. Flamers, less so. I mean, I think we should kind of touch on the second map as well, because the second map's going to be Russian Cafe.
Right.
Do you think this is maybe something... that again, Flamers have really focused on, maybe got some specific strategies, or do you think maybe it's kind of...
I feel...
Could it be that the Chalet was kind of their,
it's,
their
I
golden
think
card?
Both, and
now they're,
it's going to be tough for Flamers based on how much they've practiced these particular maps, because out of most of the maps, I think Consulate and Cafe are two that are very... They have a lot of niche things that can really make or break points. You know, just like that garage thing, you lose a bandit plant, you lose a garage. It's at that point, you just have to play better with gunfights. If you're not winning gunfights, then you're not winning.
Yeah.
You know, it's no longer about where your defense strategy is. It's more, you just have to get better picks than the attack team, which becomes much more difficult.
Yeah. And so much more pressure as well, let's remember. Because, like, these guys are playing on stage. You don't want to be putting yourself in a situation where it's like, if I miss this shot, then we lose the game.
Exactly.
That's going to make you miss the shot, that kind of pressure.
Yeah, like, definitely. No, it's definitely different. And I'm sure it's an adjustment to go from playing on the internet to playing locally on a LAN. It's whether you have a low ping or a high ping, it's still a game changer to come to essentially effectively
zero
no ping at all.
Yeah. Yeah,
and it really changes people's gameplay and... You know, mixes it up a lot.
Okay, so looks like...
Now, he says happens so often with Thermite, but I really wouldn't call it a not. I've got 300 hours in the game, and I've seen that happen maybe one time. And I play Thermite.
I said I haven't actually seen that bug before, and I've put a good lot of hours into the game as well. So it's like, I don't think it's that common, but I could imagine it being... pretty frustrating.
Especially when you're
trying to climb the ladder and it's like, oh, great. But as you say, that is being addressed anyway.
Right, it's so already been addressed and know about it. It's definitely something on the list to fix. I thought it actually made it in the last patch, but maybe it is actually the next one.
Yeah, it could be a matter of maybe just like occasionally slipping through as well, maybe. But anyway,
but we got the same setup. Same deal. Let's see. I guess it gives Bandit a chance to try and win it again.
So I think for this round, they have to run the same setup because it's going to
completely
restart of the round.
Remake, you can't change anything. Makes sense.
Let's see how they are going to go in onto this one. And whether they kind of change up that strategy, whether we see, as you say, kind of that Bandit interaction, picking up the battery, putting it down again, see whether they're going to be able to win out that little almost mind game that comes out between him and Thatcher.
I would love us to get over to there. There he is. Oh, they already got it open. I guess
that's our answer.
I guess it didn't go so well.
That's going to be Revan picking up the first one onto Boros. So nice little pick for them. And that's going to be Frost as well. Now, Frost has been absolutely instrumental for defenders across the tournament today.
Right.
Like, how much of an impact do you think, like, say you're on Flamers right now, does the fact that it's Frost going down really kind of impact your... momentum, I suppose?
I would say combined with having the garage open and losing, you know, that shotgun, that beastly shotgun, they're sweating a little bit.
Yeah.
Especially their setup right now looks like they were all kind of camping around B, which is totally going to, with Ash closing in on them on the side, it's totally going to end up with a hell of a pinch. And there's not much they can do about it at this point. not like they can really back off. They don't really have anywhere else to go at this point, so it's kind of just
hope
play it
best.
Out and hope for the best.
Yeah, they're going to be praying to whatever god they choose right now as Aera slowly but surely start to close that vice grip. However, they're only one man down, so this is definitely not all done for the Flamers. They're not in a great spot, but
it's not good positioning, but they are is still 4-5.
We've seen some crazy rounds happen, and there we go. That is going to be the equalizer. So actually, another member from Flamers has been dropped, so Revan, with his second kill of the round, is going to equalize. Oh, not even equalize, getting them the advantage again, sorry. Bandit as well, flashing health bar.
Yeah, looks like under 10.
He's not feeling too confident. That's going to be Torok again with another headshot coming through. The MP5s just seem like laser cannons.
It's a very low recoil, so it's very, you know, not the highest rate of fire, not like the P90, but so little recoil that it's very easy to really get it on someone's face and pop it.
And especially with like the ACOG as well, it's very easy to land those shots, but that's going to be another one down, but not out. That's going to be Rook, so I mean, kind of to an extent when you're Rook, once you've got that armor down, kind of your job done. Obviously, it's a good operator to have around, but not the worst one to drop. However, when he's the last man.
Oh, we saw him.
Here we go. Let's have a look at Torok. I want to see from Torok's point of view if we can, as he is the last man remaining, but he is going to go down. In fact, LM's.
His point of view is lights out, dirt nap.
Yeah, there is no point of view right now. He's all out of eyeballs as he's going to get dropped to that headshot. That was bit of a messy spray. Not gonna lie, not the cleanest kill I've ever seen.
That's one of those skip. Don't watch the replay.
Yeah, quick, no one watches
but
this.
Hey,
everyone close your eyes.
Got the kill, so.
Certainly did, and that is gonna be LM's again. 3 kills in that round. I don't know his total score now.
Panic is just hanging out. Panic's about to drop it again.
I want to see whether or not Panic's like just explodes in this last round. Just like, hey, hang on, I need to be at the top of the scoreboard. Just like goes crazy, but here we go. We are gonna see him. I assume it's him on smoke.
It is him on smoke.
Yeah, it's him on smoke. So he's going to have that SMG in his right hand. And we'll see. I mean, Flamers right now, they're 3-0 down. That is not a great spot to be in. Right now, you're 2 rounds away from match point.
Yeah.
Like, when you're playing, because obviously you play this like all the time, when you're down in this situation and you're kind of 1-2 games away from match point, what is your kind of... Are you the guy on your team that will be like, okay, guys, we've got to get this together? You the
I'm trying
sort of
to
motivator?
I'm trying to find a new mouse and headset because I just broke the last one.
Threw them out of the window.
I'm that one. I'm yelling at my Twitch chat, screaming at the people in my game, and walking around opening and closing kitchen cabinet doors because I'm so angry and I don't know what else to do.
What do you mean he sponged the shot? Yeah, I can relate to that.
Yeah.
I can definitely relate to that. I like to think that I'm the guy like, come on, guys, we still got this, but it's just simply not true.
Keep your head in the game, guys. Keep it cool. No.
There we go. That's going to be Elation picking up the first one with that F2. The Famas just terrifyingly good.
And that's at my house. That's not on a stage. On a stage, worse, probably.
Yeah. I mean, you've seen like the major esports tournaments. You've seen how passionate the players get.
Right.
Imagine like when everything's on the line, you're on that stage. Tensions are going to be high.
Yeah, but it is. I mean, it's the first 2 matches of the season, so they've got some time to recover if it doesn't work out so well. They've clearly showed they can pull it together.
Yeah,
but their first game.
I think like a huge part of it is the amount of prep they put into Chalet. So if they can translate that into other maps as well, they're going to be looking
all map knowledge. All the rest falls into place after. Obviously, you need it. You need to have strong players that can aim well. You need to have good communication. But until you have the map knowledge, you might as well not even do the other stuff.
Yeah. Here we go. Let's see if the map knowledge is going to be enough, as it's 4 versus 4 now. That's going to be Revan. I feel like I'm saying it's going to be Revan grabbing the kills so many times.
Yep.
He's definitely kind of point man here for Aera, especially near the starts of the rounds.
Who did we lose from Aera already? I didn't even see that one.
I can't tell because...
It must have been a trade, though.
Aera is like at the start of their name, so I don't have like a short version at the top of the screen. So it's hard to say.
Oh, it's Pulse.
Okay, so that's kind of a big deal, actually, losing Pulse early on, because if you've gone for Pulse, then you're kind of relying on that intel to come through for the rest of the round.
Right.
But I mean, let's take a look at the defensive positions here from Aera. Do you think this kind of It's a very wide spread, and we've got two players that are very far away from the bomb sites in general. Is that, do you think that could be detrimental to them?
I mean, at this point, I think mixing it up isn't... Oh, sorry. No, I honestly don't know. You know, it's something... something that's clearly working for him right now.
Sometimes you just don't know, you know?
But especially with Revan just walking in there and...
Just strolling in and just taking... Getting kills, taking names.
I think that more often than not, most of the better teams do spread pretty far from the bomb site. A lot don't play too close, okay. But it really depends on how
Cooks
it's going.
Cooks the grenade, picks up one. Oh,
got the trade though, so that's down. Done. That's over.
Yeah, I think that's round, isn't it? So, yeah. Well, the defuse is going to come on through. I was wondering why the round didn't end, it's because the bomb was planted.
Right,
but
yep.
That is going to be Era taking yet another round. I believe that's their fourth one now.
Fourth, so it's match point.
I mean, Era, we saw that Flamers, for the first time in the Pro League, managed to take a 5-0 map. Era kind of saying, anything you can do, we can do better. So let's head into a...
Let's get that 0-5 on them, too.
Yeah, let's head up to Consulate and see who the big men are. But I mean, Flamers, they've got their work out right now. Obviously, yep. In case you've only just joined us, the reason it says 2+2, we did have to have... a game restart due to an in-game bug, but it is 4-0, let me assure you, in favor of Era. Now they're going to be on that attacking side. Now, on this map specifically, would you say attackers or defenders typically have an advantage here?
Like we were saying earlier, I think that honestly, with the exception of the harder maps like Oregon and Plain, which are honestly hard for attackers for completely opposite reasons, I think that most of the maps have the advantage for attackers when you have a full team that plays together and trains together constantly with like full synergy. You know, when if you're just queuing up by yourself and playing with other people, probably defending, because it's a lot more based on your own personal performance, whereas attacking is made or broken by the team entirely and their ability to communicate, their ability to know like how aggressive each one of them is and how to move with each other and not just on their own going for kills.
Yeah, it kind of goes back to what we were saying earlier about you've got to build up that synergy. You've got to be able to communicate with your team and let everyone know.
And get the grenades through the...
And land the grenades.
Drone holes.
I want to call them letterboxes. They feel like letterboxes. Cat flaps, I suppose. Drone
yeah,
flaps.
Yeah, like little irrigation flaps.
I feel like I just want to nickname stuff. Maybe I'm just weird. I don't know, but I'm going to see the drones just... scouting on through. And this is something we've seen a little bit less of later on in the day, is kind of at the start of the day, maybe it was just teams a little bit more nervous first getting on stage, like using drones 24/7. But look at the spray down coming out from the pistol. Doesn't quite finish off the kill though. It's going to make it 2-4 in favor of the Flamers. They're actually
there it is. They're
managing
come back.
To get something on the
it.
Board. I think right now for the Flamers, priority number one is don't get 5-0'd.
Yeah.
Like, right. After that stellar performance.
Kind of negates
game.
The 5-0 they got if they turn around and get 5-0'd, you know?
Yeah, so. I mean, here we go. It's just going to be Sledge and Thatcher remaining. Drone just going to get completely denied here as Flamers.
Which this is, even with having that open, it's going to be tough at this point. As long as the Flamers don't peek, they have no reason to peek.
Yeah.
Minute and 30 left, 4-2. No reason for them to do anything except wait.
Yeah, just let Era walk into your crosshair. Literally, right. All you have to do is press the trigger.
Era has to either relocate to the complete other side of the map where they have no idea where anyone is, or start hitting the drop downs, which may or may not be reinforced. I didn't catch that. Nice. Or try to push through the garage, which is well covered.
Nice breaches coming out here just to make sure that there's no corners going to be able to kind of stay in. But
I don't know if I would have stood on top of it after I breached it. Not the best like move there.
Maybe be a little bit more cautious if you're going to blow a hole in the floor there. Here we go. Last man. Era right now. Undead. It's all on you, buddy. Can you get the 5-0? He's got the SMG 11.
I feel like it's Sledge in the dream a lot, you know? If there's one guy left up for some reason, it's Sledge a lot.
One man, one hammer. Here we go. Can you do a movie voice?
You like the one for
like the
movie.
Trailer voice?
Like, this summer, one man, one hammer. Sledge versus the world.
I don't know. I feel like we're maybe overhyping it.
Yeah.
He's in 1v4. Well, I mean, we'll see if he can.
14 seconds, can't hit the drop down. I don't think he can. Oh, okay. I stand. I'll shut my mouth.
And yeah, well, there you go. There we go.
Can I just say, 1v4, hitting a drop down never works. They're always covered, and you can't react. Like, you fall so slow, you know? Like, Rainbow Six physics is like, very, very slow descent. Yeah. Like, you kind of got a, yeah, I don't know, like an oversized coat on or something, and it catches you down.
It's like Mary Poppins umbrella. Right? You just, like, yeah, float down. Oh, God. It's like when you get the
C4s, too. They're very, like, very floaty, you know?
It's like attached to a balloon. It's like bob it across the room. Here we go. Dat Flamers, they managed to get a point on the board. And that's the important thing.
Panic's doing a little smoke remodeling. Busting out his little Sims practice instead.
Gonna be punching the holes in the walls. Going for the top floor here with the bomb size, so something we've seen a little bit less, it seems to be like a secondary plant location from what I seem to remember from this game. It's kind of, obviously, each and every map seems to have like two major spawn points that the defenders go for and you kind of alternate between.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think? This is kind of, do you think the basement's stronger than this one? Do you prefer this one? What's your personal take?
Again, I think the basement's the high risk, high reward plan. You know, this might be just a little more generally just play it. You know, like reinforce what you need to reinforce, open what you need to open, and then kind of just play it. Whereas the basement is a super easy win if you manage to out thermite, but an extremely difficult win if they open that garage.
Yeah.
You know, so it's a much more high risk, high reward.
I feel like that's very similar on a lot of maps. There's a lot of garages or garages. Or,
yeah. Check out that American accent.
Yeah. Casting from across the pond. Yeah, there's a lot of kind of garages in this game where it always feels like that garage is just such a crucial...
Garage.
Or the garage is such a crucial way into the map. It's like make or break if you can get that Thatcher plant down.
Because they're always right next to the objective. You know, like, so if you can get in there, then...
And as well, it's wide open.
Like, it's wide, so when you plant right in front of it, you can go all the way back outside.
Yeah. And you can just, like, sit your thermite or... Glaz, if it's a map that's appropriate for it, just like way back and just look on in, and the second any defender moves, just...
And as you see, the defenders here, they're very spread. Most of them aren't playing anywhere near the points at all. I think they have one guy in B, and the rest are all playing kill holes spread out to the top. I feel like these ones, you know, it's much more just, if you have kind of an idea of where everyone's watching, then it doesn't really matter what the attacking team does.
Yeah, and as well, it's when you're playing this kind of spread out style, it's all about call outs. You've got to be watching your team back, and that is a perfect example of watching your team's backs. Like, one guy is there, but his teammate is watching that corner, and it's going to be traded back across. Oh, the full flash. I don't even know who's winning this fight at this point. But actually, interestingly, we've got an IQ, something we've not actually touched on.
Yeah, I don't know why IQ keeps coming up. I don't.
From what I've heard talking to people, it's just a matter of
the gun,
it being a fast character and the gun that you have.
Right.
More than the actual gadget itself. Because, let's be honest, it's not that great.
It's not good.
You can
not
see through smoke.
Raid is really giving it a lot of credit. I mean, I guess it's kind of a pulse hunter.
Yeah.
You can see pulse with it, but...
You can see through smoke grenades as well. Right. So, like, situationally.
But she's cute, too, so that works in favor.
That's always going to be, like... When I'm drafting a composition, it's all about how cute the operator is.
Like, Sledge is kind of ugly. I don't know if we need him. You know?
It's like what my team has, and then the fashion kind of...
Right. Those shoes. She's got those purplish-pink shoes, and that says a lot about, like...
I really feel like Hild would have been better here.
Right. Like, I'm so confident I'm not...
I feel
really
like we should have been kind of commentating that, but... Yeah, there we go.
It's kind of the...
Talking about shoes.
Carried away with the shoes.
But here we go. We're going to be going into round five. That I believe that was Flamers.
Yeah, that was Flamers.
Take that one.
That's our bad. But
there we go. So 4-2 now.
So Flamers did not get 5-0. They are officially making... Oh, I'm sorry. That was last match. Yeah, 2-2. So they're keeping it nice and even.
No, it's 4-2 because it's +2, isn't it?
No, we're... Wow, I'm... What happened
it's
to
just
the
kind
plus
of
two?
Gone. It's,
there it is. It's back.
It's
I'm less
the
confused now.
Wasn't up,
it went away for a second.
Yeah, it's That's how.
So yeah, so they finally rectified. They didn't get 5-0'd. Yeah. So good for them there.
And they're halfway to the equalizer right now. Right. Halfway to pushing it to overtime. And actually, this is the point where it's kind of like, okay, you've survived the 0-4. Now it's Flame is kind of with a little bit of momentum, and
now
it's going to be
that
Era.
Momentum, right?
Yeah, Era are the ones that kind of have to make sure that they don't kind of tilt
shivering
off the back
in
of
their
this.
Boots or their exactly. purple sneakers. Let's not talk.
shivering in their
purple IQ shoes.
See, that's maybe this is the next step for Rainbow. Shoe skins.
Definitely, yeah.
That's got to be it.
Those would be a hit.
The competitive integrity, I feel, comes second to shoe skins, in my Definitely. Opinion. As a fashion-conscious gentleman myself.
Yeah. Now, one thing I would like to point out, yet again, just to really drive it home, is haven't seen a lot of peaks from the defending teams. A lot of window peaks, which I think is a testament to... There's a lot of... back and forth about whether it's an unbalanced tactic to peak windows at the start or, you know, or if it's a cheap tactic
whether
or something
it's
unfair.
Kind of
yeah. But clearly, the pro teams know that you do not have the advantage peaking.
Yeah.
Yeah, you might get a cheesy kill, but those people aren't paying attention. If you're paying attention, if your mind is in the game when you start, then you're not going to get...
The thing is, as well, like these guys have so many hours on the game, they know what windows are going to be the ones you go for. They know the spots. And
they know once the game is live, you're playing. Yeah. You know, it's not after you touch the building, now the defenders can kill you. So the first kill goes to Aero.
It does indeed. That's going to be Planix.
But they got the trade. Not necessarily trade, but they did
even it up.
Even it up.
Certainly did. And actually, we're going to see Jaeger flashing red as well. I hate that. When you're playing Sledge and you only get the window, look at the barricade. That is like the worst feeling.
Something about that glass, man. It stops the skeleton key on Buck. It stops the Sledge. It's brutal. It's strong glass.
I think it's when you hit the frame specifically.
Right.
It kind of screws with you a little bit. But also, the Sledge can be a little bit finicky if you're like pulling away as you hit. You've kind of got to get that frame perfect to be able to get fully out of the way by the time the barricade's gone.
Definitely.
And still hit the barricade.
So 3-4. 4-3. However you want to say it. The minute left.
Yeah, kind of a slow... I mean, we've had a couple of early kills, but other than that, still a minute left on the round, so fairly slow pace.
I think they've got Aaron nervous with the comeback.
Yeah.
And with under a minute left and still seven people, that's kind of in the... Even though they're down a player, it's sort of leaning more towards their advantage.
Well, the Flamers... They need to start to get a wiggle on here because they've got 40 seconds to play with, which in the grand scheme of things ain't that much time. They need to start to make their mark on this map, and looks like they are going to push forward. Gets heard. Does manage to dodge underneath those bullets, doing his very best Neo impression right there.
Yeah, it's pretty solid time.
Revan does find one, though, so in the end, is going to get caught out. Look at this. Two defenders left. Can they make it happen? It's not looking great, to be quite honest. That's going to be him.
I'm going to go with the no, they cannot. Nope.
Yeah.
There it is. But, hey, they didn't get 5-0'd, so that's good.
Yeah, I mean, they turned it into a 5-2.
It was a good comeback for a minute there. They lost momentum a little bit.
It was looking shaky, let's be honest, for the first four rounds.
Right.
They did manage to get a couple of rounds back in their favor, so not all is lost.
They brought it back a little, yeah.
Kind of saving their dignity somewhat.
And they were the underdog, too, and they... Definitely came in real strong and still held their own, so. And we still have one more map, too. Who knows? Maybe there are cafes on their list of maps they've trained more for.
Yeah, so we're going into the Russian Cafe. Now, I find, like, the Russian Cafe is, like, I mean, first of all, I'm a big fan of trains, so I just love the Russian Cafe.
I like trains.
I just go into the, just go into like the train room, just treat it as a museum.
Right.
And then my team's like, Rook, can you put down the armor, please? Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot I was playing Siege for a second there.
So you put it down, pick it up for yourself and break it. Say, there's your armor.
Yeah.
What, I got mine.
That's what you get when you sass me. Oh God.
It's not my favorite map. It's honestly between that one and Bank. Bank's just very open to me, and that one's just confusing to me, and also fairly open, just like Bank.
It is kind of a winding network of
a lot rooms. Of weird angles. A lot of weird angles. It's another one of those maps where you can use second floor drop downs out first floor windows to hit people on the ground and stuff like that. And it's very, can get very confusing to try to keep track of all the different ways you can die from.
Yeah, it's like watching all of the different angles can kind of get you dizzy sometimes. It's a whole lot of different ways you got to be looking all at the same time. But I mean, talking about Cafe specifically, do you think there's any special operators we might seeing out? Like, is this a map that we maybe see Glaz on, or are we going to see maybe Blitz again that we saw earlier on?
Maybe Glaz, maybe. The Blitz, I'm honestly still surprised we saw as much as we did. Honestly, I out of all the shield operators, like Montaigne brings a team element, but the recruit shield has grenades and is much more versatile and a little faster. Blitz, I don't really see the purpose of, and I've barely, even when they have picked him and have even gotten some kills with him, rarely seen him get off with like a good flash or anything like that. And so I'm very surprised that he's been picked at all, honestly.
Yeah.
But he's a fun operator to use, but I just don't see his competitive play value.
I feel like it's maybe you gotta have lightning reactions, and I mean appropriately to his icon, you gotta have the right. The lightning reactions to
you gotta blitz.
Yeah. But you gotta be able to, when someone peeks out, be ready with that flash and actually catch right. them. And then at that point, if you can do that, you have that same advantage that Montaigne has of just being able to push forwards and be able right. to gain a whole lot of ground. But here we go with the second map of this matchup. It is the Flamers up against ERA. ERA 1-0 in this series with a 5-2 victory on our first map. But here we go with the Russian Cafe.
So there's an IQ again. There he is, always popping in. Chi. And I'm not too surprised about the defender thing. Again, I'm very surprised how often Doc has been picked today as well. I expected to see a lot of Doc on Xbox when we start covering them, mm-hmm. but I'm very surprised to see so much Doc on PC. And I haven't seen Doc pick anybody up.
No.
Not often, anyway.
I think one thing about Doc as well is you have a lot of armor, so right. you can kind of go for some of those trades that other operators might not really want to go for. Like, right. if you can go for a straight firefight, especially with Brook on your side as well, if you can find yourself in a position where it's going to be hard for them to headshot you, you could maybe find an advantage off the yeah. back of your passive, but it's definitely very situational.
Like we covered before, too, I mean, you can effectively do that with Capcan as well with a much better gun. Yeah. I mean, I definitely think the Russian operators have awesome, awesome guns.
That's one point we've seen very, very little, if any, Capcans.
I don't think we've seen any today.
I don't remember seeing any. And if you don't either, that covers all games. So yeah, it's safe to say we haven't.
Say we didn't.
But I mean, Capcan can be pretty obvious.
Yeah.
Like, it's very easy to see where the traps are.
But you have to, I mean, today we've seen a lot of last minute, like under 30 second
charges.
Pushes, and that's where Capcan can really shine, because then it's kind of, whether you know it's there or not, too bad. Like, you don't have time. You have to push into the room. So if it's just sitting there right around the objective and there's 20 seconds left, you don't really have a whole lot of time to be like,
yeah.
you know, shooting out the little Capcan trap or trying to get around it or EMP it or whatever. It's kind of a, it catches people off guard in that scenario.
It's like, okay, I've got to make things happen right now. So.
Right.
I mean, maybe we'll see that later on today. I can't say I'm really expecting that necessarily.
No, not really.
But again, the IQ coming out here, like I said earlier, this is
that's a lot of surprise to me, because it's, if you like IQ's gun, it's very like the 5.52 is very similar to Thermite's gun. I think the AUG after the control yeah. rebalance it got has become a lot better of a weapon.
I think it's just a matter of IQ being one of the like lowest armor, highest speed operators, whereas Thermite is, I think, 2-2, if
right.
I'm correct. So it's kind of like a different play style, I suppose.
Yeah.
And as well, I think IQ...
Ooh. Cut into the kill hole. Distracted by the kill
Revan
hole.
Revan again with the first yeah. kill. Like, every round, man, this guy is absolutely on it for ERA.
And that's
going to be enemy as well. Frost chiming in with that super 90. Super being the operative word.
Yeah.
Here we go. So that's going to be, that really kind of, I mean, we've been talking about spanners in the works today. That is definitely a spanner in the works for the Flamers, because yeah. 3 versus 5 when you're on the attack, 2 versus 5 now when you're on the attack.
Yeah.
1 versus 5 when you're on the attack.
As you were saying.
Yeah. So, I mean, you were saying
yeah,
you like Thermite's gun. Let's see how much Boros likes it, because...
just get on him. Oh, he's dead. That's a Super 90 mess today right there.
Super 90, more like Super Methy. I don't know what that was.
I hated that worse than the other pun.
Sorry. Sorry. The longer the day goes on, the worse I get at just like terrible puns.
And that terrible
Peapod jokes.
Comment thing. Yeah.
I wish I'd said that instead of the like weird.
You know, people started tweeting out pictures of my facial expression.
I saw that. I found that hilarious. But here we go. So, it is going to be another round here for Aera. So 1-0 in their favor. And Flamers on the defending side here. So let's see whether the Flamers have a bit of a better kind of grasp on this map to what they had on Consulate.
Yeah, that attack was rough, so hopefully they can bring it together with a good defense. Yeah. Words are tough.
I want to see a really close game here as well. I want to see the Flamers that we saw in their first game of the
day. Yeah, I don't know if, you know, it was kind of got it off early, didn't save it for the whole day. They just kind of ran it out the first round.
Kind of like win the first one 5-0 and like, we're done. Yeah. I don't care.
They
like,
stepped away pouring sweat, just, oh crap.
1-3 is good enough for me. We got the 5-0, I'm good.
I don't know. I want to see him bring it back with the defense and then come in hard on an attack.
Yeah. But, well, I mean, let's see how they go. I love it when you see players do that. Just go for a pot shot through a wall. Like maybe I get a headshot. Like, what do I lose?
And we had one solid earlier today. He just kind of shot two spots, got a guy in the face, you know?
It's like the best feeling.
Oh, there's
just
nothing better.
He just like threw a wall, just like, oh, there's a guy. Nice. Great.
That especially SMG11 kills in Glaz. It just feels very dirty. When you,
yeah,
when
like,
you rip Glaz's face with an SMG11, it's just not fair.
What sniper? ACOG for life. But here we go, Twitch.
Ooh, he definitely hit him. That guy's a little confused
Pulse.
Right now. He's trying to shoot back.
Pulse, like, can you not? Like,
is that Pulse?
Well, Pulse is the only one that's lost health, so I've got to assume it was.
No, you're right. But so Pulse could see him through the wall and didn't get him. There we go.
Well, there we go. He's down for the count right
there. You'd think in the game of shooting people through the floor, Pulse would have maybe had a better shot there.
You would think that's kind of something he would excel at, but there we go. Smashing away those windows. And the barricades, no less. But Aera down 3-4 here. So Flamers with an advantage. And on the defensive side, I definitely feel like that's a huge deal for them.
That's
they should.
Very big deal.
I was going to say they should be
half the
in
time
with
gone,
a shot
down
winning,
a player.
I feel like even if you're even, defenders typically kind of have somewhat of an advantage because
as the timer runs down, as you're even, the less players there are, the more it's defender oriented, even when they're even, I think.
Yeah. Because I mean, like, they have to go into you. It's your game. Like, you've set up the traps. It's like Home Alone. Like, Kevin always had the advantage on the sticky bandits.
And now it's 2-3, so they definitely have the advantage.
Here we go.
Look at that
nice
little
headshot.
He was so ready for that one. I don't know if he heard him or what.
Yeah, I think it might have been call-outs. I'm not 100% sure, but very, very nice little. It might have just been purely like map presence, like knowing that this is going to be a spot that's going to get checked.
Right, right.
Here we go. 2-2. Jaeger and Rook up against Siege. Or Sledge, sorry. And Ash. We'll see whether they can turn the Flamers into Ash.
Seconds, so it's going to start moving real quick.
I'm sorry. But here we go. Time to push on in. 12 seconds left on the clock. This is going to be the time where Aera have to make something happen. And they have managed to get that diffuser down over on the A side.
I didn't even see him get in.
No, I didn't either. I was like, wait, what? Okay, fair enough. I thought that round was just about over. But here we go. The bomb's down. That's going to be Revan again. That's his third in the round, I think.
Once you get the bomb plant, that defender-sided 2-2 very quickly becomes an attacker-sided 2-2.
Yeah. Let's see. Torok on his own. Can he land the shots with that MP5? He's got to make something happen. He's running out of time here, so he's got to find these players soon, but he has been spotted out. Oh, nice little shot out of Torok with the pistol as well. I think he's going for the defuse. cancels it.
Oh.
I thought he was going to get that with a hip fire for a second. I was very kind of not sure of the what quite was going on, but
yeah, no, nice that changed a little bit on me. We missed it a little.
And there we go. So that is going to be again Era grabbing a second. I thought that was going to be a round for Flamers. I honestly thought
it looked like it. They when had, it, when they it was had the upper hand the whole game, and then kind of somehow let them plant.
So. Kind of like slipped through their fingers.
Yeah, that's definitely a ninja plant.
Playing against Era is like trying to hold sand. Never gonna happen. That's what my grandma always used to tell me.
Well, I mean, Era didn't. They tied their initial games against who they played before. I don't even. But I think what.
I'll have to glance through my notes. My right. memory
G-Bots,
is.
G-Bots, I believe, is the only one that's actually 2-0'd.
Yeah, G-Bots are the only one with a 2-0 so far. So Era. If G-Bots tie later on today, in fact, I think G-Bots is our next match. If they tie up against Penta, I believe they're going up against, which is going to be, first of all, a hype match. Like, that's going to be definitely. Amazing. Then we could see a tie between Era and G-Boss. We'll have to see.
Yeah.
Era, I mean, they've still got three rounds to go. Less than halfway here. But again, I feel like we've got a very, very staple meta now in terms of operators that we're going to see.
Definitely. With attackers, it's always more or less the same four. And then I guess for some reason Twitch is the expendable. I personally would rotate out Sledge before Twitch. I know he can make a lot of holes, but I just think that Twitch has too good of a gun not to use.
I think one of the things as well about making holes is like there are very few operators that can't make holes.
Right.
Like it's not something that's like while it is quicker and it is easier on like Sledge or Ashe, like most of the operators can go at least breach of charge. You're gonna be able to find ways in, but I mean, as well, you've got the argument of like signal jammers and things like that can't block a Sledge because right. like I mean, any AMP.
But when was the last time you saw Mute in a competitive match? True. I haven't seen him.
Yeah, I think that's a lot down as well to kind of signal jammer just seems less effective than the battery when it comes to denying thermite and. Even with the signal jammers, you're not going to block the scouting from the drones, really. So it's kind of... There's not huge reasons to go for Mute, I feel like.
Right.
Or at least in my opinion. But I mean, maybe that's something we see later on in the Pro League. Because, I mean, we've seen these kind of back and forths between Bandit and Thermite, like trying to get the plant down and trying to deny the plant with the batteries. Like, maybe that continues to evolve and suddenly kind of signal disruptor might become
right.
a more effective way to do that trade. We'll have to see.
Coming down to another match where it's going to be under a minute with nine players left, I stand corrected.
Super 90 comes right in. There we go. That is, again, Super 90, as you say, coming on through, making those picks.
Don't even address it by the player or the... It's just the Super 90.
It's an entity
it's
in itself.
Own, yeah.
Here we go, Flamers down to three players. I want to see them push aggressively here. I want to see them really kind of put their foot on the accelerator pedal. That's what I want to see. Peaks off, actually walking on it. It grabs two headshots for himself.
Consecutive headshots.
That's going to be the plant as well. So that's going to be, or I think they have the diffuser there. I'm not 100% sure who has that one. Looks like Thermite has it. Panic's going to get tagged out there. Still on his feet though. Does manage to duck on down. Needs to be careful, actually, Ash here. Ooh. Will go down. I think a little bit overzealous on that one, but traded straight back across. So LM's going to go down. Two versus two now. But the diffuser still hasn't been planted yet. And they've got 5 seconds. They actually have to make something happen right now. They needed to get that diffuser down when they first broke it.
About to being out of time.
What just happened?
Wow. They just didn't. They didn't, is what happened.
I mean,
there's no way one guy can cover both sides.
I don't have an explanation for that.
Yeah, I...
Because...
I kind of wish we saw what... Maybe Thermite wasn't paying attention to the clock and lack of comms. I don't... That was... I'm very surprised.
Yeah.
There's only one defender up. He can't defend both the sites.
It's got to be miscommunication, surely. Because, I mean, they just charged on in and we saw just immediately two straight up headshots. Just like, okay, right. This is my site now. And then kind of just like... Is it though?
Forgot the bomb.
Thermite was like, I don't know if this is our site. I'm not really one for like taking. I'd rather go and ask the rest of the guys first if it's okay if we plant.
Right.
And then didn't. Obviously didn't get permission.
So Arrow going back to the Fae 5. There they are. Sledge, Twitch, Thatcher.
Thermite. We've got a Pulse as well.
Pulse is back, yep. Doc is gone.
Back on the scene. We've seen very little Book today as well. That's one thing I've noticed. It's kind of, we've seen a couple of instances of Book coming into play, but not really.
Who?
Book.
Oh, Buck. Yeah. It was actually, just as Simon covered earlier, like he's kind of an underpowered, sort of weaker operator that they're looking at. You know, so it was surprising to actually see him take the place of Twitch earlier today. But I think that was the only game that won.
Yeah, I think we saw like two, maybe three rounds, if that.
Yeah.
It's kind of underwhelming, to be honest. But, I mean, who knows? Maybe we see that in the future. Maybe that's something that gets changed in future patches. We'll have to wait and see.
I mean, even if his ability doesn't quite push people in the same, it does give you kind of that long and close range ability.
There's definite merit to the shotgun as well. Because, right. I mean, like, especially, obviously this is the highest level in Europe team play.
Yeah.
So, like, in terms of matchmaking, you're not necessarily going to see the exact same stuff that you're going to be seeing here today. This is very, very different circumstances. So,
definitely.
In terms of matchmaking, like, you're spraying through a wall, you run out of ammo, you can immediately swap to that shotgun for when they peek. It's fantastic.
Right.
But there we go.
First kill goes to Flamers in this one.
Which is very important, I think, because they've... The first kill is something they've been losing out on.
Right.
In
they've been
rounds.
Playing at a disadvantage for most of the games. Yeah, and last time they almost had it on defense and just kind of let it slide. So hopefully they can bring it together in this one.
This is going to be kind of... I think right now this is deal breaker for Flamers.
Right.
Because if they don't win this round...
It'll be much harder on attack.
They have a straight up reverse sweep that they have to get into over time. So it's kind of, you know... A little bit of a tall order, to say the least.
Right. Once again, they're facing that 5-0.
Yeah, it's...
Not dream. Nightmare.
Nightmare, yeah.
Yes.
It's never a place you want to be. It's kind of... This is the situation where in matchmaking, if you're 3-0 down... Oh, nice little kill. That's actually really good for Flamers.
There
they're looking for more.
5-2.
Elation with three. Elation
he's just three. Like, no. The MP7 is a beast. I mean, that gun is so easy to control. High rate of fire. It just shreds people's heads.
It really does. I mean, you just saw
it's now 5-1. I mean, if they don't get this one, I'd like to say, that was a complete 5-0. They just
team ace
didn't
right
lose
there.
A single player.
Very nice. And this is what we need to see. And this is kind of the thing that I want to be seeing out of Flamers.
Right.
It's kind
they
of all
have,
on the line
they
right
have
now.
It there. They're just not consistent, you know?
And, like, we've seen twice now, players from Flamers just step up and just dominate players from ERA. So, like,
that was a hell of a play.
When you're already three rounds down, that's the kind of thing that you've got to be bringing to the table. You've got to make those plays and you've got to make things happen.
Right.
We're going to see that in that round, and now that's going to kind of alleviate at least some of the pressure because it's no longer just going to be turning into a 4-0. It's now 1-3. There's only a 2-round difference, which definitely sounds a lot more manageable than a 4-round difference.
Definitely.
It's like...
I think twice as manageable even.
Yeah, you might be right on that one. That's some excellent arithmetic, my friend.
I took math once.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's better than me. Math was never one of my favorites.
Oh, I didn't say I did well.
Yeah, just took it. That's true. That is true. Well, I mean, I did okay in maths, actually.
They just keep bringing back IQ. I don't get it.
Well,
they need more devices. They need...
I mean, with the amount of IQ they're bringing to the table, they're definitely going to be good at maths, at least.
That's true.
But whether or not they're going to Rainbow Six Siege is a different matter entirely. Not a whole lot of mathematics comes into play. But hey.
I don't know. The compass and protractor helps for all the angles, I think.
Yeah?
So, yeah. A lot of angles to be played.
Kind of just like, hey, guys, can we just pause? I need to get out my measurement equipment. I don't think that often happens. I feel like most of the time I just live in a completely different world to the rest of like players on this game. But here we go. The attack is
finally
on.
Inside. Finally inside.
Into the building and very
some
enemy. Very very
enemy knows he not in a good spot there.
Yeah,
moved. He's out.
I think he.
And honestly, it's almost better because he's gonna sit there looking for him for a while, and
yeah, you kind of stall that player. Kind
right.
Of. They don't. He's out of earshot on where yeah. He went.
Take a couple one. Shots and run, and that attacker's probably gonna sit there and. Look around for you for a while.
Yeah.
And with the 3 minute timer instead of four, that matters.
Yeah, it really does.
Especially when you know it's pulse.
Well, 1 minute and 30 on the clock. Five players remaining for each. Although, could see
something
enemy.
About to happen.
Enemy again seems to just be like diving between yeah. Cover, dodging bullets right now. Oh,
oh got him
nice
with the throw peek.
Yeah. So there we go. Headshot as well. So no chance of him being picked up.
You do not see the prone peek like that work very often. No. Not at all. But he totally caught him off guard there.
The thing is, like, with this game, there's a lot of, like, dashing between cover, like, just going for 1 second peeks. You can't do that if
right.
You're prone. But that is going to be Revan as well, chiming in with a headshot of his own. That's going to be 3 versus 5 now. So that flame is on the attack. Kind of on the back foot once again here. I mean, what. What do you feel like the Flamers need to change up here? Because this is a consistent thing that we're seeing them drop players at the start of the round.
I think it might be, honestly, once again, sounds like broken record, but it doesn't seem like they have the map down. Because I feel like a lot of players can defend better than attack on a map they don't really aren't as comfortable on.
Yeah.
Attacking is definitely something you need to know exactly where you want to be going and looking. And if they don't really have the playtime on the map, then they're going to have a really hard time.
I think one key thing that maybe isn't here for all of the teams just yet, but I think will be by the end of the Pro League, is kind of not just where you want to attack, not just what operators, but also kind of like attack route. Like,
right.
This person is going to gadget here, followed by we go up these stairs, followed by this person's covering this corner while I go up here. And
exactly.
That kind of systematic pushing. And that is going to be another round over to Era.
And that's nice something level. I definitely think, yeah.
Match point as well. Era, I mean, I want to get super hyped for this game, you know. I want to be, like, screaming to the heavens. But honestly, this is a very one-sided showing from Era.
Right now, it is very much a favor of Era. They're playing a lot harder than Flamers are.
Yeah.
And
this is the thing, like, you sometimes see kind of overhype coming in. I don't want to, like, overhype something and, like, kind of try and make it seem super crazy when it's kind of... we've already seen super crazy games today.
Right, definitely.
So I don't want to kind of
they
do them
the
an
shot,
injustice
though. I mean,
by just screaming about everything.
G-Bots would have been yet another tie if they hadn't reverse swept in almost the same exact scenario. I believe they were 1-3 and came back for a 5-3 win. So
that's true. If I did, wasn't it 0-3? I wrote down 0-3. Maybe that wasn't true.
I think they had one, but it could have been 0. I don't remember exactly.
But yeah, the G-Bots kind of...
But regardless, a pretty heavy sweep back
and
in the
as well,
direction.
that was the first game as well. Everyone
right.
Had kind of hyped up G-Bots saying, like, this is a team that
yeah.
Could be a dark horse, could be a massive contender. Went, like, 1-3-0-3 down to Sifu. And then we're just like, hang on, guys.
Absolutely.
We're the G-Bots. I mean...
So they mixed it up, brought Buck back in, and took out Thermite for Buck. So they have Twitch and Buck.
Wait.
And no Thermite.
So I think this is actually the first round all
definitely
day.
Definitely the first round
Thermite.
All day without Thermite.
And I feel like if you're 4-1 up, you've already got one of the maps won. I mean, this is the kind of time where you can experiment with this sort of stuff.
Right. I don't think... I think they're going for the gunfights in this one.
Yeah.
And Buck is not too bad at gunfights.
No, absolutely not. I mean, you've got essentially a second primary.
Right.
That takes zero time to swap between, so... Why not, you know? But here we go. Going to go for that James Bond entrance. Kick through the barricade. And charge on in with that.
Although Arrow... Oh, no, it's 4-4 already? Okay.
Here we go, he's going to find an enemy and just gets denied. So clearly, Frost the better of the two new operators in that
yep.
1 versus 1 right there.
Yep. Well, you take the not so great shotgun versus the arguably maybe too great shotggun and...
Yeah, I mean, the Super 90 there getting its Super 90th kill of the day.
Yeah.
Feels like. But here we go. I mean, 4 versus 3, Flamers still with an advantage here on the defensive side. Yep.
They definitely are much better at defending than attacking on this map. 4 versus 2 now.
And that's going to be Boros as well, getting a
second
kill.
Again, another Super 90. Although he's hurt now. Less than third of a health. And it's tough.
Well, I don't think he minds, yep, because he's just got to kill bear the bear trap.
Right in the bear trap.
And there's QB as well, finding one for himself. And that's going to
turn
it
kill into... cam, there it is.
Oh, there it is, beautiful.
Nice. Whoops, I slipped. Smack, bumped his head and killed himself.
There goes Yoshi and my friend. That is going to be a second round for Dat Flamers. I feel like that was kind of maybe...
It's a beautiful ragdoll is what that was.
Yeah, it was.
Just kind of slipped right onto his butt.
Yeah. It's kind of like when you step out of the shower.
Yeah.
There's a puddle on the floor and you're just like... Whoosh.
Yeah. Panky and I were definitely mentioning how hilarious it is to see the kill cam when it is a frost trap. And it just... The ragdoll effect every time is just funny to me. Yeah.
And there was that one as well. There was a cartwheel. That was hilarious.
The cartwheel was solid.
I got a lot of kill cams. Kill cams are just... I don't know if any of you guys saw during the alpha build, some of the kill cams were just ridiculous.
Oh, yeah.
You would see like only the feet and the rest of the model. It was like the feet and the guns, like the hands attached to the rest of the model, kind of just like going all over the place.
I'm surprised Flamers is yet again bringing IQ. I mean, it hasn't worked for them once. I don't know why they wouldn't try mixing up some of the operators, but they're very persistent with taking the most useless ability in the game.
Well,
I mean, if it was working for them, I wouldn't knock it, but it's not, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I guess on the other side of things, you could argue maybe if this is the strategy that they often run, maybe don't try and kind of... Don't play the operators that you're not used to when it's kind of on the big stage, you know?
Right.
But again, as you say, it's kind of, if it's not working, maybe something does need to be changed up here.
Right.
There we go. Pulse again coming out here for Era. Doc and Rook Smoke has been a staple throughout. Rook and Smoke, definitely two of the top dogs in terms of defense. No Frost coming out, though, interestingly. Frost has definitely been... at least kind of second to third most popular operator
for
the day. I think Rook kind of takes the cake. Smoke as well has been just about in every single composition.
Yeah. And then of course some attackers, Thatcher and Thermite, no surprise.
Yeah, that combo. Finally saw the first round without a Thermite.
Very surprised to see Thermite go on that.
I think Ashe as well has been really up there for attackers, which I wasn't expecting as much. Nice kill there by enemy to open that one up for Era. So. Flamers on the attack, one man down, once
knife.
More. Actually,
the
no, they
knife.
Managed to get one there onto enemy. And that was a trade as well. Enemy was the one that got the original kill, so.
Right.
That's kind of a vengeance, like avenging his brother with the knife, like dramatic.
Just get
kill.
Real personal.
It's like something out of a movie. Here we go. I mean, if you're going to do something out of a movie, I feel like the Russian cafe is going to be the place to do it. Feels very kind of. I don't know. Gunfight movie-esque. I don't know.
It's got trains.
Yeah. It does have trains. That is very true. There are trains in movies, ergo, it's a movie film. Movie film? I don't know what I'm saying. You talk for a bit, dude. I'm done. I quit.
So 4-4. 58 seconds left is definitely in favor of defenders yet again, but...
Panic.
3-4, 2-4, right as I say it. Yep, there it goes.
Is this where panic steps up once again?
Is it in favor of them, though? With Revan. Revan. How do you say it? Revan?
Revan, I think.
Yeah.
Here we go. And then
she's right
forward.
Above him. Oh, wow.
I don't know what's kind of going on here. Two of them kind of just watching
I thought he
forward.
Downed. Oh, was that
no,
Doc?
No, they both
Doc.
Just ducked behind
I think
forward.
Doc finally just got himself. Did?
Yeah, I think. I'm not sure whether he got himself up or whether he managed
Wait,
to dodge behind cover.
Okay, maybe. Okay.
I think it was that he dodged away, but Thermite last man. It's going to be Boros on the scene once more. He finds one for himself. He's in a 2 versus 1.
Just I want to see. Pick up panics, though.
I want to see from Boros' point of view right here. Or not, because he's already down.
Yeah.
And it's going to be undead, making Boros re-dead right there. Final kill of the game, and it is going to be Era. They're not chocolate bars. They are, in fact, players. And they are going to be able to take that second map in a row. So 2-0, our second 2-0 of the day. Honestly, pretty convincing against the Flamers there. They felt, it looked very comfortable for them. Flamers I mean, phenomenal performance on Chalet, but not really able to turn that into anything more.
Yep. It's they had a little bit of a stance, you know, a little fighting stance back, like they wanted to do something and couldn't quite get it all the way through.
I mean, I don't know, but it was a hell of a statement to get into the Pro League. Like, here we are the Flamers, let's do this, 5-0. But then it kind of just, it was like a fantastic takeoff and then suddenly kind of just started engines failing and then just plummeted into the ground. And unfortunately, lost 3 games in a row. We are going to have Sean on stage, I believe, with Panics. Yeah, so Panics kind of MVP of the day so far for me with that 1v4 clutch. I want to hear from his mouth how he's feeling heading in 3-1. Let's pass it over to Sean on the stage.
Thank you so much, guys. I am indeed here on the stage with Panics. Sir, GG, how do you feel?
I feel great. The game against that Flamers was really fun and good. They played really well, but we're still a bit mad about the draw on the first game. But overall, it's a pretty good day. Everyone had a draw almost, so it's pretty good. I guess we played good, and I hope people can see how we play in LAN and enjoy the game and just feel good about the game. Yeah.
Now, you mentioned it right there. You're here on LAN, you've got everybody around. It's technically the second day of the Pro League, but we're playing it in one day. You just got a kiss on the side of their head. What's the feeling like being here, surrounded by the team, for the first time kind of hanging out together in this environment?
To be honest, it's like my first PC event, so it feels great. It's a bit weird at the first time because I don't know, the game feels a bit different, and it's hard to get on the first day. But to be honest, it was really great to meet the guys. It's always fun and a pleasure to meet for the first time your friends and your mates. But there was also the other teams, like we meet everyone from the French, from Spanish. Everyone is great. So we're having a good laugh with the other team overall, and it just feels really good. And the show is incredible, so yeah.
Incroyable. Now, I'll ask you one more question, and then I'll let you get back and enjoy with the guys. This is it. You had your first 2 rounds of the Pro League. You're done for the day. Are you happy with your performance, and what will you take away? How will you kind of prepare for the next play days?
I think we would have been happy if we had won 4-0 on the first day, but I guess that everyone had some troubles to play on the first day of the Pro League, so we can be happy about that, I guess. We'll try to work out on Chalet. I guess we'll maybe ban it or or we'll maybe work it. We'll see. But yeah, that's it. We're going to work a lot with Undead, who is the new players in the lineup since like Friday. So we need to work with him, and then we can only have good hope with the team. And I think that's it. Like, really good day overall for a team who has a new stand-in for our week. Yeah.
Well, we absolutely loved having you. Thank you so much for taking the time to have a chat. They're going to go off and actually start thinking about what they're going to pick as the bands. I'll let you go away. You can stand here right with me. You don't even have to leave. Panics, what a gentleman, what a nice guy, and of course, has done his job. 2 plays here today. We've still got 3 more to go, but let's break this down, and for that, pass it off to the man over there who always can. Over to you, Panky.
Thank you very much again, Sean. Another stellar interview. And we have been joined at the desk again now by another very special guest, the team manager for Penta, Felix Valias. Thank you very much for joining us. How are you guys doing? A very new team, very new esport, and your first event, IEM Katowice, is a big one. How are you guys feeling?
Well, I first fell in love with Katowice like 2013.
Yeah.
First Italy Extreme Masters, one of the first events for me. And it was just huge. The Polish crowds are just amazing. They're fans of every game, they're very supportive, they're very nice people, and I'm always glad to be back.
Yeah, 100% agree. This is my 4th Katowice. Love it here, it's brilliant.
Yeah, it is.
Let's dive straight into that last game. We just saw 2 brand new maps, State Alphabet, Consulate, Cafe Dostoevsky. Hadn't seen those at all during the Pro League up until now. Flamers, unfortunately, couldn't quite bring their performance out from the previous game. I know you were very upset about that. True. Do you think they had any possible reasons for that? Was there, like, did they not favour those maps so well? Were there glaring holes in their gameplay?
I don't know. Maybe they got a bit tilted from the really, really good start on Epsilon, and then they just kind of lost it at the end, and maybe they just followed for that kind of tilt. Could be.
Possible.
There's a lot of reasons. Like, there was
having that 5-0 suite is really good for them, and they should always focus on that one, go on upwards.
Yeah.
I don't want to ask you too much about your feelings of that. Of course, you've got to keep things close to your chest, but Consulate to Cafe, do you have a favorite in either of those two, personally, if not the team?
Probably Consulate. We don't like Cafe that much, but... Well, you need to be good on every map, and this is I think this is the reason that the new team, the Flamers, did not that well, because they simply did not have the time to prepare. He was giving an interview, and he said, literally 2 weeks ago, we did not know that we would be here. We're a new team. There are like a lot of maps to play, a lot of spots, a lot of positions to learn. They will definitely get better. This has been a good start for them.
Yep.
Our era is over. Is the overall first seed.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep. And they did respectably well against that. They had some close rounds or rounds that could have gone the other way. And yeah, I also don't think they tilted. They basically, they go here, they come here to Katowice, and they have like zero expectations. They say, we're qualified, we fulfilled a lifelong dream, and we will like take every map like it comes. If we lose, we lose. We are going to stay friends, and yeah, you'll just see how it goes.
It's definitely an amazing start. It's definitely like 5-0.
And it's the perfect thing with it's a pro league. It's not just a tournament. It's not done, gone now. They've got many weeks to improve and train and get better and
get them
all the way back. So they've definitely got the right mindset about it. I want to talk to you guys about your next game. Penta, you guys are playing up against G-Bots. G-Bots have come out and said they think you are their toughest competition in this tournament. They think you're the guys they're going to be fighting for position with. Do you feel the same the other way, or were they a non-factor until you saw them play today?
Well, certainly we have a lot of respect for G-Bots. They're a very great team, very dedicated players, very individual skilled players.
Yep.
They can take us, we can take them. It's like a matter of mindset. I think the skill gap between us is like very small, and it can go either way.
Mm-hmm. So again, I don't want you to reveal too much here, but I want to get in these deep questions. We speculated about it when we were casting, and I'm not sure these guys did too. We saw an IQ pick again. I want to get more and more opinions on this. Why do you think some of these teams are playing IQ, even though her gadget is widely regarded as basically useless?
Well, I think there is a simple question to that, simple answer to that question. Basically, she's a good all-rounder, she has good weapons, and if you have all the gadgets you need, or you feel you need, why not pick a operator that you feel comfortable with, that has a great weapon, where you can like basically focus on aiming, focus on out-aiming your opponent. It's like, if it fits into the team, it fits into the team.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, that makes sense. She's like another recruit.
So we're going to take one last quick look at the rankings. Just as this comes up on the screen, has there anyone that's played today that's completely caught you by surprise? Or is it Flamers with that first win? Were they the guys everyone else, expected to be down there?
Actually, they did not surprise me. They were, they're coming into this tournament as not as a dark horse, but as clear underdog.
Mm-hmm.
But all the other teams did not have information on them. They did not know how they play. Mm-hmm. They used it to their advantage, definitely.
Yep, so there is our standings as they are right now, because first game into our Play Day 2 on your screen. These are the games we got left. Penta Esports obviously up against G-Bots next. Sifu versus Warrior Team France coming up as our penultimate game, and then Epsilon versus TCM to round it out. I don't want to hold us up from those games any longer. We're going to run to another very quick commercial break. We're going to take another switch desk between casters and whatnot. When we come back, we will see Penta Esports versus G-Bots. Words are hard.